Welcome to the podcast about venture capital, where investors and founders alike can learn how VCs make decisions and reach conviction. Your host is Nick Moran, and this is The Full Ratchet.
Welcome back to TFR for another edition of Investor Stories. On this segment, the experts talk about a startup that failed and the causes of that failure. Here's the segment called Postmortems.
On this special segment, we have Reed Christian of CRV. Reed, can you tell us a story about a portfolio company that failed and why it failed?
I had an investment at Battery that didn't necessarily fail, but ended up being kind of acqui-hired. So wasn't a financial return. And the mistake they made was competing with Datadog. And it actually was a great founding team, had a differentiated product, but we weren't able to crack distribution. And Datadog, you know, out-executed us, partnered up great with AWS, and just kind of out-executed on kind of the product-led growth. And distribution tends to be an area that that startups do fail to competition on. There's got to be a unique wedge. There's got to be something magical about not just the product, but really the distribution. And I think you got to innovate on both. And we did a good job on the product side and weren't quite able to crack the distribution angle.
On today's special segment, we have David Goldberg of Alpaca. David, can you tell us a story about a portfolio company that failed and why it failed?
We need a whole show to go over some of these. Sure. And I want to be mindful of who I talk about in terms of their failures, but I think one that he'd be okay because I think he published something. I was a pre-seed investment in a company called Leo. Leo, this is probably 4 years ago or so. And there's a couple of people who have now tried to replicate this. They were basically like a one medical model for pediatrics. And the way that they tried to do it was instead of building out their own four-wall model and practice, they partnered with like an emerging practice to give them basically like a distribution channel and a already established or growing customer base. And I think the lesson there is that like partnerships and distribution channels are really everything and becoming more and more important, right? And even on basic consumer companies, if you're acquiring all your customers through Facebook, Google, Instagram, what have you, you are not setting yourself up for long-term success, right? If you could spend the time upfront finding the right partners in distribution channels, building out that moat, your business and acquisition gets better over time versus worse over time. And so the lesson really there was, they didn't really think about the dynamics of their partner. It wasn't the best win-win relationship, and it was more of a short-term plug than a long-term solution. And ultimately, it was a big contributor to their demise.
On today's special segment, we have Mac Conwell of Rare Breed Ventures. Mac, tell us a story about a portfolio company or an investment that you made that didn't work out and why it failed.
So the very first company we invested in out of the pre-seed fund we started in the state, it was a woman building this tool to help with implicit biases. Really loved her vision, loved the way she was going about it, but didn't pay attention to some of like these subtle red flags, right? She was a Black woman, and she, you know, we mentioned, you know, she was a lawyer, and we're like, you know, well, how come you didn't talk to any like your friends from college or try to do a friends and family round? She's like, well, I didn't have any friends, you know, I couldn't really get along with anybody. It's like, well, she went to University of Colorado, there wasn't any other Black people in her class. Maybe it's an issue, okay. And then it's like, you know, she can be a little harsh with people sometimes, but sometimes the craziest founders are the wildest founders are the best ones, you know. So, you know, it's okay. Then we notice like she's going through a bunch of developers. It's like, why are you going through so many developers? Because nobody wants to work with her. She's just a person that nobody wanted to work with. She wasn't the kind of person that people wanted to deal with. And so very quickly we realized, like, oh, we didn't spend enough time getting to know who she was as a person. Because it became glaringly obvious 6 months in that, like, what did we just do? Why do we do this? And so that was a lesson to pay, like, and now I'm really, I pay so much attention to the little things when I'm talking to a founder. Like when I'm talking to a founder, especially if you got co-founders there and you have co-founders talking over each other, our co-founders correcting each other, co-founders not being polite to each other. Oh, those are red flags. And those are red flags that very often we overlook because we're thinking too much about the business. We got to be thinking about the people too. And so that was the lesson I learned from that one.
On today's special segment, we have Neil Sequeira of Defy Partners. Neil, can you tell us a story about a portfolio company that failed and why it failed?
Sure. There was a company that struggled and could have been a, what I believe, a gigantic business. I've never really told the story, so hopefully Avner doesn't get too mad at me. But 12, 13 years ago, I was looking at the video infrastructure market and video from both the creation stage all the way to the end consumer, and loved the picks and shovels in between. So invested in Elemental, which was an encode transcode GPU, huge outcome to Amazon AWS. Hiwins was a content delivery network, great outcome. Really hard on the end consumer. So how are people going to watch video IP? There needed to be a new EPG. There needed to be a way for people to find content easily. There needed to be something. And a brilliant, brilliant person, Abner Ronan, by exploring all the options out there, he had developed an open source platform called Boxy. And the technology was core open source. And Boxy was, you know, being used by literally tens of thousands of people. And ended up investing and with Fred Wilson and Bijan from Spark. So Fred from Unisquare, Bijan and I were on the board. And I have more respect for Fred and Bijan than probably any two early stage investors in the country. I just think they are thoughtful, especially about companies and opportunities like this. Media is a hard business. And when you're trying to... And I'd actually worked at a media company. So I understood that when you're trying to go after these bigger players, what you end up having to do is often poke them in the eye to get the attention of everyone else. And we developed a box and sold it. And alongside Roku, we actually had a lot more sales. We had 100,000 units sell on a venture-backed company that basically you plugged in. Think of it as the first version of Fire Stick or the first version of anything where you could access IP-driven TV. And the challenge was a company like Roku, which would be deemed the largest competitor, took a very different approach. Abner's approach was, hey, I'm going to beat these media guys at what they, you know, fundamentally do on a daily basis. And Roku said, I'm going to partner with them and I'm going to do a little bit of an end around where I'm going to get my software on a bunch of this new Chinese TVs that no one wants to touch because there's, you know, too much lack of clarity and the, you know, Asian software development isn't going to be able to do what we do. And so it was more of an end around versus, you know, think of Netflix when they did their Stars deal, right? How is Netflix going to get the content? They did it end around. They did a deal with Stars. So all of a sudden they had a bunch of content on Netflix, you know, which I would argue is one of the best business development deals ever. And that's what really catapulted the company because people could get on Netflix and actually see content. And in this case, you know, we went straight at the belly of the beast. And that ended up being really hard for people to handle. So, you know, while we got to a point in the business, and I love the story because we had another term sheet to do a huge round of financing. And by the time we got there, the people who could go at the belly of the beast without doing somewhat of an end around like Roku and Netflix did were really Google and Amazon. And we made a decision when we were going out for that round of financing that we should find a home with a huge partner. Because if you're going to go directly, you know, and dance with the elephants, your strategy usually is best served to figure out a unique approach. And we were really entering directly and competing head to head. So luckily we found an exit to Samsung and it could have been, and that team is still there and thriving in many ways. I was lucky to back Abner again on his next endeavor. And obviously we were happy that it found a home. But, you know, there were some great businesses started in and out of that time period. And look at Roku stock today, and you can see what obviously, you know, Netflix of the world have done. And sometimes just take something creative to find a way to, you know, kind of unseat the incumbents at the table.
Interesting.
That will conclude this installment of Investor Stories. If you're enjoying the program and would like to see it continue, take a moment and leave a 5-star review in iTunes. Also, if you'd like updates on new content from TFR, as well as the top 10 VC articles every week, go to fullratchet.net and sign up for the newsletter. Okay, that will wrap things up for today. Until next time, overprepare, choose carefully, and invest confidently. Thanks for joining me.